Welcome back to the second part of the Breaking Heads podcast number 21. We are still discussing the Harlequin list from Liam, the winner of the Warhammer Championship 2021. My name is Fred. I'm the founder of the Breaking Heads, and with me doing the interview is Tom. Hi, Tom. Hi, Liam. Welcome back.
Hello there.
Hello.
So I'm really looking forward to now really dig into the meta and the different matchups the Harlequins have, and find out if all this stuff, general stuff that Liam told us about stealing objectives and never rolling dice and so on, really holds true when we see how he fights against the other armies. Because I feel this meta we are in right now in the 9th edition is as diverse as I haven't seen ever before. And I think there are many strong contenders. And yeah, Harlequins is one of them. And I'm sure there are some tricks how the Harlequin still then come out on top. And I think we all agree that Harlequins are a really strong army, and the performances from players like Liam have shown that. But yeah, let's see how it really turns out in the game then, and in the points showing at the end of these. So Liam, before we really tackle one specific matchup, I always like to ask my guests like a tricky question. And I know this is even trickier because we are playing so much TTS nowadays, and TTS always like one game per week or something. And you can basically, you could basically be doing lots of preparation hammer, like really putting all your models down and reading all the rules up front and so on. But usually if we are in an analog tournament, you cannot do this. And from what I've seen from you, you're also playing in many games, tournaments at the same time. So this might not be as relevant for you as well. So my question for you is, how do you tackle an unknown matchup at a tournament if you have no time to prepare for it in advance? Like, you just go to the table or go to the, just load the TTS, and then just someone comes up and say, yeah, by the way, this is my army. What is what's your way of approaching this?
Yes, it's I think I have a good understanding of most army in the game, so that helps a lot. But when I don't know, I just go and play it. Like, I have my plan, I have a common plan, I'm just going to use it and see what happens. And if I get shot, I get shot. That happened, I suppose. But I think I tend to... My plan is already very safe overall. Like, it's only depend of me. Like I said before, don't roll dice. Taking very obvious secondaries that I can achieve whatever is my opponent and things like that. So I just going to follow my gameplay. And I think I have a gameplay where all right into most... into, in generally speaking, against most army. And
So your preparation happened way before that, because you built an army that is very unreliant on the opponent's plan.
Yes, and also of course, I play the list a lot, and when I play the list a lot, I face a lot of opponents. So, like, if I don't know something, I'm going to use that. But in tournament, I'm really not often surprised by the list I face. If I can give an example, I never faced the Orc list I faced in the final on Warhammer. And so I follow my gameplay. I just say, I was thinking, oh, maybe I go aggressive. I want to use my bike. And then when I begin to choose a second, I was there. No, I don't want to. I'm just going to take Warriors 10 engage. And I think I take bring it down at the end because he had a lot of vehicle, but whatever. I took something, I engage in Warriors 10, even it was my gameplay. It was what what the list. And at the end, I lose a Warriors 10 and stuff like that. But I think not knowing your opponent, playing very defensively, allow you to learn, in fact. So really, I would maybe play differently if I face that type of lift next time, but I learn a lot like this.
And you said you have a good general understanding of most armies by now. And I guess playing a lot of games and playing a lot of tournaments definitely help by that. But maybe if you could give like a tip for the listeners, how did you get this understanding? Do you have a specific method, or you just like grind down all these games?
So basically, I think I like to look to tournament results. So I look very often to like stream online on random tournament from Australia or stuff, or TTS tournament, and I see a lot of lists coming. And when I don't understand a list, I go check everything in the codex and read a little bit. I always, of course, check to. I have a lot of time, so I play a lot, so that helps, of course. But overall, I think like it's very like you learn a lot by just looking to other games, like even in Discord. Like I say, I have a lot of training partners, and often I just look to their game where they are playing. To other guys I know that are playing, I just look and learn like this. You can learn without. There is things that you can learn without playing. Like just it's what I would say, it's more theoretic, like all the stats and things like that. And you can have a plan overall. Of course, maybe the plan is really, you can only say if a plan is good if you play it and you see. So plan is going to change if you play that. But overall, it's a good approach to, if you don't have time, if you first time facing them, just follow your plan. And if it's not a good plan, you will have to change it. But you follow, like you voila.
Yeah, I can see that definitely. And with the Harlequins, especially, you can react a lot. And also playing a reactive playstyle, as you elaborated in the beginning and of part two, you can react to the opponents and their plan and change accordingly.
Yes, it's really, yes. Reacting is really important.
Yeah.
And if you react, you have the tempo on the game, I find. And as a Harlequin, I like that a lot. Like, I choose engagement. I choose when I charge, I choose if the opponent charged me, like, because I have the threat range. And that as a Harlequin, like, if I talk to Harlequin player, that help a lot, but yes.
I want to highlight for all our listeners that the point you made about watching friends on the Discord, I think this is one of the huge advantages we now have with this big TTS community. It's just, like every day, almost at every time, you can go to your Discord, your local scene where it is played, and you can watch other people play. Whereas you usually, of course, you can go to your clubhouse and watch some people play there, but it would be only at certain times and so on. And now we really have these opportunities, and I would urge everyone to just like go and watch on the Discord, and you can learn a lot.
Yes, and when there is tournament analog, like watching to stream, there is very often some stream, even if the quality is not great. Like if you cannot follow the game, you just check the game, look to the list, and like look every turn what happened, and that just helps a lot. Like in background when you like paint or doing other things.
Okay, but now we have to come to the matchups, and let's talk about the following factions and how your army fares against them. Let's talk about what things we have to look out for. Let's talk about a bit of the strengths and weaknesses your army list might have in these matchups, and especially what secondaries you pick in these matchups, even if they are always the same. You get to say it's the same. And I try to categorize them a little bit, because there are obviously too many to really cover. But yeah, let's just start with the general, like really vanilla Space Marines by now. And I think the vanilla Space Marine taste right now is like this close combat Space Marine, like the Vanguard veteran with the shield and the claw. And you see that with White Scars or Space Wolves a lot. How would you say would be the matchup from your Harlequin list against such Space Marine list?
So there is two parts here. There is the White Scar, Raven Guard, Blood Angel. I think that one is relatively easy because I trade very well for the Harlequin, I mean. And I mean by trading is that I'm going to charge with 5 bike, kill 5 Vanguard vets, and then I'm going to move back. And then I'm more faster than you, so I'm going to choose when I trade, and I can go out after fighting, so I will always trade in a better spot than the Space Marine one. So because of that, I tend to always win those matchups. And what I do is, like I say, I follow the plan. I take engage where we stand, and either the mission scrambler banner, and that work overall. Like it's against those one, it's always really close, I think. But overall, you're going to win by like 5 to 15 points, because the Marine always also have good secondaries. It's really because if there is any, I'm going to at one point go deny his objective, because my stuff are OPSEC, and even if there is right of war, the right of war cannot be everywhere. So he's going to deny me one objective, for example. but me, I can deny him two objectives after and always trade up like this. And at the end, I will win by a couple of points. But for Wolf, that's a little bit different. Like I have a good Wolf in my friend, a Wolf player. So the fight last is really a problem. Like the armor of Ross and the fan. They can all, but not that Judge Share is not as relevant as before. But the spell, so Hurricane last to do a unit fight last is obnoxious. And the fight last armor of Ross are annoying. And also the problem are like unit like Wolfen where you cannot trade because if you fight them, they fight on death. And they have really killy character, so that one is a little bit harder than Wisecar and Blood Angel, for example. But it's going to be a close game, and at the end, it's still possible to win, but it could happen that you lose, I think.
And but, how do you win against the Space Wolves then if they have these tricks making you fight last?
So there is two things: the spell. It's obnoxious, but you just don't do anything with the unit that fight last, and in my slide is fine. And the armor of Ross, there is little trick, like you use the mechanic of heroic intervention, basically, because the armor of Ross is only in 1 inch, for an engagement range, but he has a 0 CP for character that allow him to do a 6 inch heroic intervention. And you need to know that not everyone knows that when you do a heroic intervention, you have to move closer to the closest model. So you can use that to make that the heroic intervention is not going to reach the unit is important for you. Like you put a random boat like 5 inches back. But of course, against good players, they know that as well. So they are going to make every shot to make that it's not possible. And
But it's also tricky for the Space Wolves to place in such a way that you cannot place a 22-inch moving by transport. That is the closest model.
Yes, it's tricky. Yes, but I think it's more experience. I'm thinking I tend to lose more often against Wolf than against the Blood Angel and White Scar.
I guess it's a bit really using all your speed and tricks and then abusing. And if you are smarter there, then you come out ahead. But if you are just a bit stubborn, you might lose against the pure strength of the Space Marines, right?
Yes. Because the real problem is when they put everything in your face. Like you can, like the interrupt is a big problem. And the fact the fight lasts. And with all the fight lasts, they can make you fight less and then you cannot interrupt. So that's the big problem when they rush at you. But when there is a more like when the Space Marine tend to play defensively, like try to like have your Oath of Moment, don't go too crazy, it's really easy to win. It's because you are more faster. Against a straight up fight, I could lose, but I'm tend to fight the mission and play the mission a little bit better than the Space Marine. So that's why I win.
I think there's a very, very good next matchup we can tackle, and I differentiated with this one from the other Space Marines. That's the Raven Guards. We have seen Raven Guard like getting like a little bit springtime again. As I think it was last year that Raven Guard Centurions was so right. I think around that time, Raven Guard Centurion was the bane of everyone, and then they faded out the whole year, and now they're coming back with Vanguard veterans jumping into your face first turn, and we've seen lots of experimenting by different players. Also, in our team, we had someone with Raven Guard and Ultramarines, which worked really well. How do you tackle this matchup? I saw you even play this matchup in the championship.
Yes, I did in the championships, but I was going first, so I think
boring.
If I going first, it's basically facing a Marine list a little bit worse than usual. So, and I remember me playing that matchup once and them going first. And I remember that basically if I can make sure that he can only charge me, not shoot at me before and killing the transport, it's relatively easy because he have to trade Vanguard Vet for killing transport and not really the inside. So at that point, I win the trade. And if I manage to take the first turn and manage to don't lose a lot, depending on the mission, I think. Because on a long edge deployment, I think it's probably harder than on a like battle line or sweep and clear. But if he only keep both and I manage to kill him back, it's better. Like I like, but it's difficult to say. I didn't play that. I don't think I play it against good player enough, or like I win it the time. But I think it could pose a problem. But yes, need to see, to be honest.
Is the 12 player squad important here?
If they die, it depends on what they trade. But I can always, if I feel they're important on the matchup in the later game, I can put them in deep strike. And also, if they are really important, I have enough layout of screen to screen them. Like I can screen them with bike and stuff like this. So
yeah, I would think that that's maybe something you would do. Use all your jet bikes and star reverse to protect this. And then even if they come into you, you have like this huge...
Wall.
60 attacks that just kills every Vanguard.
Okay. Yeah. And also, Vanguard Vets with Lightning Claw are not really great to kill by. Like, they are good, don't get me wrong, but I guess a 10-man, it's not the same thing as a 5-man, but a 10-man would kill a 5-man bike, I think, but it's close. It's close. Without 2 damage, like 40 attack, it's like 27 hits, like 3 wounds, and it's like 10 to 12 wounds, so you kill not all the units, and so it's close. It could really happen that he only killed 2 bike and a half, and then you have like a half of a squad alive. That happened to me, like, but you could get lucky with that one. And even if you lose all the squad, like, after that, it's really fighters straight up. After the turn one, he's facing a Space Marine list without Vanguard Vets, basically. So you have, So you can take your time. Even if you lose the time, you just grind and dumb using all your strats, and at the end you come back. And even if you take a big lead in the beginning, later turn is really really important. I think it's more important than the early game, so you can always take the point back later.
Maybe one last point to this, because our Raven Guard list in the end, how do I say it? Like, if it goes first, it's good and so on. But I think the big advantage of the Raven Guard and the whole infiltrating from the Space Marine is that it makes Space Marines suddenly very fast, because the biggest disadvantage is they're really slow, but Raven Guard gives them the opportunity to be on the whole table, like basically have affinity speed in the first, like before the first turn, and then they'd be like slow as normal Space Marines. Do you find, or maybe we can just only think about it because you haven't played that much against them, that could be an issue, that if they really take the whole board, it's harder for you to get them like really off from it? Because usually how a Harlequin match works in my experience is that you're always the first to be somewhere because you're so quick.
That's true.
If you want to, like, and then they have to like grind you out of the behind the ruin and so on. But if what if they are hiding behind the ruin and so on?
I guess you charge them. No, but that's true. If they take the board and don't charge you, I could see that as a problem, because that put the pressure on you. But if you're fast enough and you can move up them, like if they put the scary unit in the middle, you just go in their deployment zone, you know, and you make them have to go move back. That's why having the double move is sometimes useful, is that with a single move you can go at front of your opponent deployment zone, but if I use a double move, I can really go in the opponent deployment zone and moving not 44 now, but a little bit less, 38 with a unit of bike in one turn, make that I am in his opponent deployment zone. But yes, I could see that as a problem if they don't charge me, like,
but I see that they would probably have the problem of being too spread out again, and this is always bad against Harlequins. It's just we didn't really see this army against the Harlequins, so I have killed evidence on it either.
Also, I could really easily focus on one side, kill everything on one side, and just be that point he's like he lose a lot, and I have I'm going to hit him before because I'm the opposite of the bigger unit he left. So yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just switch deployments only. It happened very often.
Okay. I think
looking at the time, exactly. We should probably move on. There are a lot of matchups.
I'm on it. So now we talked about faster Space Marines and so on. Let's go to very slow Space Marines, and then we can finally leave the Space Marines behind us. There's Dark Angels, and I will just put them together because they came out as, like, these books came out very close together, like with the Death Guard. Like, these very slow-moving, very tough armies.
I would put Custodes with them in
fact. Oh, yeah, and the Custodes. I always forget them. Sorry, Golden Boys. What do you think about these matchups?
For me, it's really... there is one match where it's difficult, it's battle-lined. But on all the other mission, you have the tempo, it's really easy. Like, you choose everything. Like, he has any choice. He cannot choose. Like, if he take, like, the Dark Angel takes two bomb defense, there is one turn you can invest the resource to just deny him that. So in solo tournament, you can make that you win by a little margin. Like, you win by a couple of points really easily. On battle line, it's different because the only four objectives make it really harder. So you have to engage a little bit. That's why, for example, the 12-man player of the 12-man unit of Caress is there. So I'm not going to kill. I don't think if I go into like a Dark Angel Terminator, I kill it, but like I can make that I kill important stuff, and that help a little bit. But I think I would lose against those army in the hand of a good player on that mission specifically. But I'm fine on all the other missions.
Because you can spread out more and have more objectives to fight over, and they cannot be everywhere.
Yeah. And even on battle line, I think I can make it close. Like in team play, I can make it close enough that it's not a 20-0. Enfin, I don't know. Enfin, we are talking about single here, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. But I think I would lose.
Like, no, I think these team tournaments are also interesting. We just.
Yes.
We don't have the time to always play two matchups out of it, sadly.
Well, I think I would lose, but I still never lose it for the moment, but I should lose, I think. Like,
what makes it so hard that they can stand on the objective and be there? Because Sodas and Dark Angels also have the OPSEC there.
Yes,
I guess with Death Guard, I guess you can also just kill the... Poxwalkers.
Death Guard is very more easy. The problem I saw is that... you're going to have to invest resource to deny him the primary, and you're never going to be able to score more than a 5, I think, overall against them if they play well. Because the two objectives in the center is too close together. He always going to be able to reach you, and you're not durable enough to keep those objectives. So at the end, what happened is that you're going to play a game that you deny the opponent, you deny him. And at the end, I think going second is possible. Like the second turn is really important because it's unwinnable if you go first, because he is going to score 15 at the end. And if you go second, it's you who are scoring 15 at the end, I think. So it's really swingy, really, really swingy.
But this is all for the battle lines now, for other missions.
Yeah.
You would have more opportunities to score primaries, be fine with the secondaries, and
So that's why overall I would say that if I talking without matchup, battle line is always the worst mission for the Harlequin.
Because it forces them out. Yeah, I see.
Yeah. I think for Custodes, I just want to point out that I have one unit. It's in the unit that is specifically for that. It's the 6-man unit with Embrace, because it's the AP3. That means that I can actually kill Terminator if I need it, even if we don't see as many Custodes Terminator that we used to back in the day. But this unit is really there to do that, because I can spend 2 CP to have +1 to wound, 2 CP to have 2 damage. And at that point, I can kill a 5-man Terminator. Enfin, cripple them enough that even with no reroll and ignoring, I kill them.
Sometimes against these big units, it's enough to cripple them, right?
Would you agree? Yeah. Yes. If you kill on a 6-man unit of Terminator or 5-man, you kill 3.5 or 2.5, it's enough. And also against Custodes, the Shadow Seer is clutch.
He does more damage than the rest.
Yeah.
Okay, then looking at the time, we are going to go to another matchup, and I will summarize this under the monster matchup, like fighting against really, really big monster units. You already said that, for example, you cannot kill Mortarion with the players. No. How do you deal with Mortarion? How do you deal with like four Keeper of Secrets or the Tyranids who are running around with typically two Demacarons right now?
Yes, and also the Herodule, right? So,
all these Fortress.
Mortarion, against Mortarion, I have one thing while killing him, and he is called the Death Jester. The Death Jester is just every turn one-shotting Mortarion to make him minus two movement. And the threat range of Mortarion moving the 24 to 22 is huge against Death Guard. Like, it makes that I can actually play around, and Mortarion is not going to win a game by himself. Mm-hmm. So I just make that he never reach me, and it's a little bit like a mouse and cat play, and I kill the rest. So Mortarion is, I don't think it's a problem at all overall. You don't kill it, but whatever. He's not going to reach you. If you can give him it, like, oh, go for five players that are dead in my hay, okay, and anything like this. He's never going to reach my bike or my 12-man player, for example.
Mm-hmm. And the keepers and the Tyranids?
No, for the keeper, it's the same exactly, because keeper doesn't fly. So on big birds, you just move block them with boat and easy clap. And also, keeper only have a 5-up involve, so all your random shooting, like bike, boat, grenades from player, pistol from player, you're just going to chip damage. And against keeper, you have a very good strat that allow you to reroll all wound and all hit for one CP.
Ah, yeah, that's so brutal.
So that help a lot also. So that matchup is not a problem. The more mortal wound spam from demon is more a problem, I think. With like a bird and some thousand sun and some pink and durable obsec, that one is more a problem. This one is a problem, I think, but we tend to see a little bit less that much, but I think it's going to come, and that one is really hard. I think you need to really, it's going to be a question of like, do you manage to deny his secondaries, to kill the obsec quickly enough, and to not die too quickly to mortal, like to not expose you? On a dense table, it's going to be more easy because they need line of sight. On a less table, it's going to be harder. But overall, the demon matchup is drawish too easy, I think.
The stratagem, I think, plays a big role. And sometimes they can get lucky. They can get like minus one to wound and four up invo save on everything. Yes, but you still have the option to just go for the obsec and then win by the mission.
Right? Yes, and keeper are so easy to move block. Like, you just use a boat and two boats, and he doesn't reach the half of the board on WTC map. So really, really easy to move block. And then the Tyranid is, I think, a little bit more complicated because I don't have fusion and they can actually move across model. So I think that's one or two, like, I think that there is a very specific build that's the, like, three big monster plus two Herodule, like, bunch of big monster, like, with the Swarm Lord and things like that. That one is a problem, really, because the idea of the list is just running at you and you cannot deal with five monster in one turn. It's not possible for the list. You can kill one. The two monster list is all right because, like I say, you can kill one. So if they only send one Dima at a time, you just kill the Dima they send to you. And the Dima is not that great to kill you, to be honest. Like, he's cool, like, he's going to kill bike, but even against bike, if you manage to roll the 5-up on the dice to not get mortal wound to death with the tail, like, he's not, like, he doesn't kill a whole unit of bike. Like, he killed three on average, something like this, four maybe. So that's useful.
In general, the Tyranids don't really have the weapons against Harlequin, right? Because I think the Hive Guard, we talked about in this part one a little bit, they have a great threat and I always feel very uncomfortable when I cannot hide and be shot at. And it's like, yeah. Oh, they have D3 damage. So I'm thinking, oh, they're going to roll all threes. But if you look at the end of the turn, of the turn of shooting, it's like, oh, okay, I lost two boats. Yeah, well, that's not the end of the world. And this was already a good shooting turn for him then.
Like the guys, the guys made the mistake to shoot at the bike. So at that point, it's winning. Like, if the guy shoot at the bike, like, okay, you shoot at the thing that doesn't use, that is not useful in the matchup. So, all right. So the boat are really, and also the bike with, the boat with T5 minus one to hit make the hive guard really inefficient. Like with one unit, one shooting unit doesn't kill a boat on average. So he need to double shoot and, the Tyranid is really about you go a little bit more aggressive than usual, I think, and that's fine. Like, so we talk about those right now.
Yeah, and Tom, do you have any more questions to the Tyranids? You've switched from the Harlequins to the Tyranids lately.
Yes, I did. I do play the monster mix with two Demacarons and Hive Tyrant and Swarm Lord and so on. And I think what you say totally makes sense because it's exactly that problem. You can be extremely fast with these monsters, but normally if you really have to go far, as you described your playstyle to be quite defensive, most likely I will only be able to send one at a time, which makes it manageable. Right? Pushing everything into you is only possible if you take the middle of the board. And if you don't do that, I think it's very difficult for the Tyranid to unfold the full power. Although I have to say, I think maybe when it comes to the matchup with Harlequins, the fusion pistols are the bigger threat. If somebody has a lot of fusion pistols, I think it gets a little bit more scary for the Tyranid player overall if you have the monsters.
Probably, but it's still winnable without. But
of course, winning the game is not about killing the units, right? It's about making points. Yeah.
And also, it could go wrong. Like the problem with fusion pistol for me is the fucking dice. Like if you put 20 fusion pistol against a Dimacron and you don't kill it, you're sad. Like you're very sad.
Yes, you're right.
So, like, yes, fusion pistol are very useful in that matchup. But that's why I was basically in my list. I have one unit of fusion. It's just to put people in respect. Like they say, he has a fusion boat. I have to avoid that one. Yes. And the thing I'm more happy is like when people are measuring 29 from my fusion boat to say, he could move like 16 his boat, fire and fate with him, and then shoot his fusion. I'm there. Do that. I don't care. I'm never going to do that. But if you're scared, it's winning for me. Like,
The big thing. That's the big thing about this boat, right? I mean, it could be 24 damage, but it could also be 4. So it's
zero.
It could also be zero. Even if you hit everything and wound everything, it could still be 4.
I think we are just talking about the fusions again. If you go fusion heavy, you should really go heavy. Yeah. And really, you need to have a shooting list. You really have to try to kill the opponent. And then it's sometimes okay if your fusions, like you have five fusions and they could actually kill a Demacaron. And I've seen it. And I've also put three walls next to it and didn't kill it. You need to have other units to complement that. For example, I use these, like some Craftwood stuff. You can also use, I don't know, no Void Reavers, but I'm sure you can use some Dark Elder stuff now, or whatever you want, and be a very shooting list. But if you're only having like 30 fusion, we can just calculate. This is like 30 fusion, 20 hits. It's like less than 13 wounds, maybe. Then he has a save. So you realistically kill one, maybe. And it's like not very good.
And if you spike in any, there is like the variance is too big to actually rely on.
Exactly.
So yeah.
Okay, you mentioned the mortal wounds with the demons, and I think also sometimes the Tyranids can have some more mortal wounds. A list I really like was the demons list I saw lately, and in general, the demons can be very tricky with these horrors. You mentioned that before, being very hard to kill and also shooting mortal wounds against you. I guess this must be very difficult in general to get the mortal wounds into your Harlequins and just go through your as we have discovered, very, very, very difficult to penetrate four-up in Vulnerable Safe.
Yes. I have an advantage in that is that I'm playing that list, so I know that list by heart, so that'll help a lot. And for example, what I saw is that there is some trick you can do, like using the engagement range to force him to do your smite. Like, for example, when you charge like something, know that the fact that Psyker cannot cast anymore and fall back help a lot, because those the Psyker are generally not that killing close combat. So you, like the burst, for example, I'm very often tagging, like, you tag the bird, he does nothing anymore. Like, you just send one unit to go die to the bird every turn, and he's tagged. Thing like that. Also, you can do more, I think what's more funny is to tag the bird. If they he go within 1 inch of a wall, you tag the bird back in the wall, so he cannot see you and can smite you. So there is little trick to do it. And I did
this
win.
They are so mean. They are so mean.
Yeah,
such a mean Harlequin player you are.
Yeah. And also against that list, you play really, really defensively. It's the opposite of the Tyranid. You play really, really defensively. Like that, I just give him nothing. Like if I take engage, I'm okay not doing engage turn one and two. Like I throw nothing. Everything is important in the later turn because every boat is like a smite suck up. Like. Everything is you need everything in the later term, so I play really, really cagey in that matchup.
And then later, you rely on every wound you have, but in the end, he cannot kill you quickly enough.
No, that's the I know that by heart because I'm playing that. Mm-hmm. I know that that list cannot kill everything in one turn, he needs to grind you down to win the match. And if he has nothing to grind the two first turn, it begins to be really hard. Because also, those lists are not as quickly as the Keeper, so he's not going to begin to deny your primary in the one and two turn. Like, you need to deny your primary turn three, turn four. So basically, you draw on primary in the early game, and then when I think Harlequin is better to deny primary. It's like one of the best factions to do that. So at the end, you can win by a couple of points.
If you really know what the opponent does, then you can really counter it. And the Harlequins usually have the movement to really not be punished for these things as much as other armies.
Yeah.
You were saying hiding against the demons because all their smites are direct, right? They don't draw line of sight. There's another army really off meta, which is the Grey Knight. Also can do a fair amount of mortal wounds, not as much as they used to. But still, there are some smites coming at you, and they shoot indirect with some bolter, psychans, whatever. How is this matchup for you?
So I never play it, so I would love to try at one point. But I think the problem of the Rey Knight actually is that they don't have durable obsec. Like they have the Paladin, and of course you're never going to kill them. It's you just not try. But I think if you kill everything else. I think it should be alright. Like, it's a little bit closer than the like Death Guard matchup, like Death Guard Dark Angel. Like, you never kill the Paladin, but you kill all the random chaff. And at the end, he may kill you with the Paladin, but if there is only the Paladin, it's not enough. Like, it's a lot of combat. Don't get me wrong, but it's not enough, I think. But I would be interesting to test it, and it could be in fact very bad, and maybe. Not good. I mean, don't know what I'm talking about here. So,
But I think it's very dangerous. We are lucky that everyone else is keeping the Grey Knights down.
Yeah, I am. I prefer facing Grey Knight with Demon than with Harlequin, I think.
Well, this is brutal. Yeah. Okay. To be honest,
I don't know. It's really the answer that I have to that.
I think I played this once, also with the Frozen Star boat list, and it really worked, as you said, just kill the troops and hide, and it's really hard to hide, but you cannot kill everything, and I think many tough matches can be won with Harlequin by just having zero models on the table at the end of the game, but just a few points more than your opponent.
I agree, and That's actually, we are going to talk with AdMech is actually the strategy, I think. So I don't know what's the next, if it's...
Okay, yeah, let's go AdMech. Yeah, that's fun.
Yes.
Because that's the shooty matchups. What do you do against AdMech who shoot like crazy and indirect and have screens and shit?
Yes, the AdMech is exactly that. You have to try to be aggressive. You have to be aggressive, try to kill the OPSEC and try to have a lead. You're going to be table at the end. There is no way you survive to AdMech, I find. But you can make it close. Like I several lose by like 2 points and or win by 2 points. Like you can make it close. You have to go crazy aggressive at 1 point, I think. And that's a matchup I don't like because you have to roll four up. Like you have to be able to survive a little bit more than usual to win it. Also, what you have to do is roll a 9 in charge because with the bomber, you cannot put the 12 man player on the board. So you have to put them in deep strike. And have try to kill, like to hope there is a spot, kill the bomber as soon as... The first thing you kill is the bomber. That's the more obnoxious in the world for you. And when the bomber is dead, you try to kill the dog, of course. But when the raider. Mm-hmm. When there is 27 of them and that you cannot charge them, it's really hard. So, yes, I think overall, it's a matchup. It's really scary. Like, it's going to be really dicey. And overall, I think it should swing into the AdMech favor most of the time. You could like steal that game, but it's really hard. And in this, I would go crazy aggressive against that because you want to tax stuff. And if you don't have like, you have to rely on the mistake of the opponent, I think. But yeah.
Tom, do you have an idea how you can get us out of our AdMech fear? Like, because I totally agree. I hate this matchup. I still have my bad memories of my match last match in the big analog tournament. I was like, why do I need to play against AdMech now on day two? It's such a bad matchup, and I sometimes see it. Like sometimes it feels easy. You just go in, and maybe if you have some fusions or if you have the high wear bikes, it's like
you roll hot on those bikes and you kill two Scorpius in one turn or something like that.
Exactly. Maybe the point is that if you roll really lucky, it's the easiest game ever because you just go forward, you shoot like five fusion pursuits, five raiders are dead, you shoot two units of bikes, and then suddenly two disintegrator are dead as well. And you're like, oh, cool, now it's nothing coming back anymore. And then, my games went is like, two units shoot, and then. Nothing dies.
The first idea that comes to mind that would make it easier or take away the fear is let me play them. That makes it much easier. But the second one,
Liam already said that if he makes a big mistake, yes, maybe you can tell us, Liam, what are the mistakes that we can abuse from that mech.
So he is a little bit too aggressive with the dog. Like he moves a little bit too far in your line, and you can manage to like go around him and tag all the dog. And make that he doesn't fall back. To tag the boat and be able, if you manage to kill the, basically, if you manage to kill the dog and the plane early, he loses all his scoring. So even if he tables you, you're going to be able to score a lot. So that's a mistake he can do. If he go a little, if he played defensively enough, it's really hard. What other mistake he can do? Let a gap to let your player come in his deployment zone and manage to do the dine and charge, but that's really, you have to roll the dice again, so that's something tricky.
I'm gonna cut that out.
okay.
But we already do have some information about what's gonna happen in the campaign book, right? And there are some new stuff coming.
Yeah,
up.
Yes.
How does that influence the overall fear?
I hope a big stream is out, but that's my wish list. it's going to be difficult to see. I tend to like a more electro priest spam list that run at me because I can deal with that. And if he has a little bit less shooting or less dog than usual, it's maybe a little bit more handy. Like less the plane and the dog are actually a pain in the ass for me. Go for it.
I feel if the AdMech list becomes more well-rounded, then it becomes easier and becomes more similar to the Tyranid matchup, where yes, the Hive Guard is really annoying and it can kill lots of stuff if it rolls good, but it doesn't table you anymore. And then it's more like, okay, they can keep shooting at you and you really are under a lot of pressure, but you can take the pressure and you will lose stuff, but you will not lose your whole army. But if, for example, the list you guys from Hottest Takes were running at the team tournament, it was basically just, oh, I can shoot as much as I can, and then I have the biggest screen possible. So yeah, this list is very extreme, and maybe my hope for the new book is because they are pushing a lot of the units that use Lucius now, except for like maybe weird things like scramblers or something. Maybe the Artmag will have more, I don't know, close combat units and so on. And then we can deal with that again.
Also, like less reroll to make them like -1 to hit really effective and things like that. But yes, like the Scorpius are not the end of the world. For me, the plane and the dogs, really. I hope they are gone. I don't want to see them anymore.
Okay, so there are more matchups to cover, right? So let's probably move on.
Yes. Okay. Do we need? Yeah. So we. I want to talk a bit about hordes. So, for example, Necrons can run lots of hordes, also with some mortal wound spam. Obviously, the old school orc horde is sometimes seen, but obviously not very prevalent. And we also see sometimes more Tyranids running more gaunts and so on. They're all very different, of course, how their lists look. But how do you deal with like just lots of bodies?
So against a lot of bodies, so I'm going to talk first about small bodies like T3, T4 with a bad armor save like Orc and Tyranid. Necron is a little bit different. But basically, my list has a lot of shots. It's a little bit hiding, but like if you look to those players, there is one weapon that is, I think, the best weapon for player in shooting is the Plasma Grenade. And that thing is a strength 4 AP 1-1 damage, blast D6 grenade. And because I tend to be close to my opponent anyway, I tend that those grenades just putting 10 shots per unit with the 4 pistol, I just screen the orc really easily. The horde, not the orc. And also the bike is really useful in those matchups because they are good against vehicle, but they're also good against light infantry that can have blast and just shoot 30 shots every turn. And the boats are also really clutch because against Orc, who are mainly a deep strike army who come and charge or advance, you can move block them with the boat. And the fact I'm running close combat weapon give me a lot of attack. So like I said before, the 12 player, if they manage to trade for 60 boys, and it's clearly possible, if I spend the CP, it's like golden. So I think that I like the matchup. The Horde is really fine because I kill them. I think Horde is fine. I'm used. I never lose to that. And I heard that was a bad matchup. Someone finds that it's a bad matchup. But for my list, it's alright. Maybe for fusion spam, it's a little bit more difficult. I don't know.
If you didn't have the 12 players, would you evaluate this differently?
No, I did face. I think 120. Boys without them in the Greekhammer and still 20 nil them easily, like the bike, and it's just a random shot like from everywhere of your army. Like the guys come at you, he doesn't expect taking like 80 shots in one turn, like that's the fact. And
it's like hidden in every unit.
Like if he take, I have like 25 player in transport, it's like 50 shots overall with blast, grenade, and things like that. But yes. And
okay. Necrons.
Necron, yes, I was talking to them. I don't know. Like, I face them. You're not going to score a lot in the early, but if you kill them relatively quickly, and also they don't, like, not. I'm not talking about the Catanlis, but more the Obsec Canoptech full. That doesn't kill you really well, right? Like, Wraiths are hitting on 4, like, with a -1 to wound on player, thing like that. And you're kind of going to kill them in, like, 2-3 turns, so it's going to be a close one. I think you not win by a lot, but and it could swing depending of how good the save are and the reanimation prototype. But I think you win that if it's not battle line, because battle line is really hard because there is no comeback. But I think it's all right. And the Catan list, it's a little bit the same as the... Basically, one thing is when you play full embark in boat, the Fallen Star power from Catan is not really effective against you. So that's nice. And after that, it's really like the... It's really like the demon list. It's just you have to avoid the Catan. And if there is Catan, there is a lot less obsequion, so you kill them faster. And at the end, it's fine.
Would you agree that when the Necron came out, just the Frozen Star list just on foot or mainly on foot was kind of like a liability because of Falling Stars?
You mean a good matchup with Frozen Star troop?
No. If you wouldn't have the transport, but you were running like not 5 men, but 7 or 8 men units, you are very vulnerable to the to the Falling Star.
To the Falling Star. But at the opposite, I'm very good against the 60 player is a lot better against the Obsequion. The full Obsequion is fucking, it's really easy at that point because you're just, it's really dumb to play. You run the 60 player in the face of your opponent. Mm-hmm. He's going to interrupt, but he's going to be tabled in 2 turns. And at that point, it's easy. But yes, it's a lot harder against triple Catan, I think, yes.
Yeah, no, I mean, not even triple. I feel like every Necron is incorporating at least one in their list.
Yeah, one Catan is manageable, I think. You're going to lose.
I don't like losing these 3 players every turn, because if you have big ones, he's going to roll it.
Yeah, I don't like either, but you know.
The thing is, you're fast enough, you would play it aggressive.
Yeah, well, I think if you play 60 player on foot, is how you play it. Like, you're not going to wait 60 player. Like, you just run at him. And like, also, you're doing mortal. You can do damage in every phase. Huh? That's why like Shard of Light is really useful, because it's a targeted smite. Mm-hmm. So there is, you can maybe not kill a Catan in 1 turn because it's kind of tricky, but for sure in 2 turns. So if So the Catan is not going to, like, you're going to take 2-3 turns of Falling Star, but it's manageable. But 3 Catan is really not manageable.
Yeah, we also had one running the Tesseract Bolt, which does 3 mortal wounds flat and gets +1 to the roll for Falling Stars, and can do. I mean, it's basically does more mortal wounds than 3 Catans. And then 2 Catans.
He has the rules of losing only 3 wounds per turn.
No.
And his vehicle, right?
Yeah, but we in theory it would still do all the stuff 2 turns, which is a lot to put the hurt on all your foot flogging players.
Yes, but he's a vehicle, so AOR come clutch. I guess.
But you need it's very stringy. That's why I hate all these matchups where you need to kill something with the Haywire Bike, because they can kill everything or nothing. And I think even, like, the average is that they do like 30 wounds to him big vault, and it's not enough because does it have 40? I think it's like 10 left. Whatever.
He's 20 wound overall. 24 wound overall. Okay, yeah.
I don't know anymore, but I think in general the boats give you so much more movement and protection that this for me it's not even a question anymore.
No, it's the best for me. The Star Weaver is the best unit in the Codex.
Yes, exactly.
Like, I win so much game with Star Weaver only. Like, so yeah.
Okay,
looking at the time, we need to get going. And we have 2 big ones, I think, ahead of us. One, of course, is the Tukari, which we will cover last, as we said. But I think what would also be interesting is the mirror match, I guess, because there are still some guys around who heard that Harlequins are good and are keen to play them. So you will face a couple of mirror matches, won't you?
I always want to face mirror match. It's very fun when I saw the disappointing of range 0 fusion pistol. And I think overall, because I have more close combats, I tend to win that match every time against the Soaring Spite. I don't talk about the mirror because at that point it's just dice or player level, but like a more Soaring Spite build with a lot of fusion. There is the Troop Master who could come and kill my Shadow Seer. So I basically have to screen my Shadow Seer very, very well. But after that, I'm just going to kill the boat and what's inside, and the bike, I have unit of kisses to kill them. Kiss player with kill Skyweaver really, really effectively. So I think overall it's a good matchup for me. But it could go wrong, I suppose, because it's Harlequin. So like, if I don't play well, I made a mistake, I would be punished. But if I don't, I think it's better for me. Like, I don't rely on Fusion Pistol, and I'm only close combat. So, like, five player kill five player in close combat. But I guess it's true without a weapon. But no, I feel confident into them.
Yeah, yeah. Range zero on a pistol is a real bummer. That's for sure.
Yes.
Fred, do you have anything else on the mind, or shall we move on to...
One thing maybe is that the mission is really big here, and if maybe you play something more closed up, where the objectives are close together, or you can really take a central position with your your Shadow Seer in the middle, the fusion guns do nothing. But if it's more like...
But to be honest, I'm not scared of fusion anyway. Like, even if I'm like, he can come and shoot fusion into my boat. Most of my army is going to be out of range. The bike, the player are going to be, the boat probably not. So he's going to trade boat. But like, also, if he put five fusion pistol against a Starweaver, the HOD are really hard. Like, you cannot put five fusion on a Starweaver and hope you kill it. Like, it's not going to happen most of the time with -1 to hit, winning on threes for a Pimvolve. Like, fusion are really bad into Harlequin overall. Yep. So you have to put more, and if you begin to be too... Yeah, like, if you have to put, like, three boats to kill one of my boats, and then I can react with all my army again and kill all of the three boats, because I have magic, I have the bike, I think I can probably kill three boats and whatever there is inside. So it's a bad trade for you. So...
I think the best target for the fusion is not the boat, but the bikes.
Yes, and the bike will never be out of the 6-inch aura.
Ah, okay, yeah. And then the mission, that's what I meant, then the mission comes into play, because if we play, for example, Vital Intelligence, where it's like spread around the middle line, then, of course, you can really defend one corner very well, and I have my fusions do nothing there, but on the other side, they will be there, and then it will be very interesting. Maybe a draw, maybe some good moves, maybe some dice.
Yes, and also I tend to play my back in the corner anyway. To play the mission, I use my boat anyway. So you're going to kill my boat, but I don't like. Also, depend on the terrain, I suppose. But like, if you kill the boat with like I say, you cannot trade one boat for one boat. It's not going to happen. So if you begin to trade one boat for two boats, it's a bad trade. And the bike are going to be clutch on the long game, I think. But yeah, I'm maybe too big a Frozen Star fan, and I'm not really...
I think the bikes are the best unit here. And like, obviously the players are important, but you will always have the same amount, and actually you don't really need close combat weapons in the player fight and so on, so they are fine too. Yeah. And I think it's even a bit better for the fusion boats to be able to do something against you while they're still in the boat, so you need to get out first, and this might be a liability. But your bikes, if both have the same amount of bikes, then your bikes are the better bikes. And this is going to help. This is going to help in the long run.
And also, I have little unit of player. You cannot trade fusion for bike. I can trade player for bike.
And honestly, I've never played against 12 players ever, and I think they're going to be super painful to play against.
Yeah.
I think that's actually, that might even be your one of, like, next to the bike, the strongest thing in your army against the other Harlequins, because no one runs that many Harlequins nowadays. I feel
the one unit of player is really useful in a lot of matches. Mm-hmm. I feel like not running bunch of foot, and because in that matchup, yes, the fact the bike have flat 30 shot, I'm not going to light that in, so I don't know.
Yeah, you wish you could, like, just kill two guys by itself. And then...
Yeah, but on most of the map, it's... Yeah. But it will depend also. Because, like, if there is no bike in front, like, there is the Polish list.
Yes. I was just thinking of them. They run lots of players, but then they don't have bikes.
Yeah, and then I can shoot the player, right? So, like, me, I can shoot the player. And like you say, five player trade for 10 player, like there's, so I think I have a good matchup against that list.
Mm-hmm.
If it's six fusion boat and 10 bike, it's a little bit closer, but I still think that I'm advantaged by the fact I don't rely on fusion anytime soon, but it would be interesting to see.
Yeah,
so looking at the time, we still have one pink elephant in the room.
I have one more, Tom. I have one more.
Okay, squeeze it in.
We've got the sisters. And,
The sisters, yes, important.
I was thinking, sister is... at the beginning, I thought it was difficult, and then I play it, really, and in fact, it's really, really easy. Because two things, your OPSEC and most of the sister doesn't run, like, 30... sister, so you just focus the sister, the OPSEC girl, and then it become a open bar. So, basically, it become a really, really easy because you're just going to deny him every objective. The other part is that sister cannot kill both. Like he has retributor, but out of line of sight boat, never going to be treated by sister. So if you kill the OPSEC, he cannot just send an OPSEC model to take it. And if he wants to send a unit to contest it, like, he has to engage stuff. And then if he wants to begin to trade Repentia, he's going to trade badly. The Repentia are only good against the bike, really. And if you can manage to don't get hit by the Repentia, and you choose your engagement because you are still faster than sister, mostly. So, and I win on almost any mission. I win that.
Yeah, like how important the Star Weavers are here, right?
Yeah, the Star Weavers are clutch again because he cannot deal with the transport. Like, and also it's T3. You have so many strength 4 shots. You can just kill so many things in one turn. Like, it's not even like you don't Repentia in the open. You just shoot at them. You don't trade. You don't charge them. You shoot. They're dead. So yes. And the really important part is the screening. You really need to learn to screen with that, against that. Because basically, you have to be able to screen during 3 turns the whole board, almost. Because sister tend to play a lot on deep strike and charging, or deep strike and shooting unit. So if you can screen the whole board and choose where the sister are going to come, it's golden. Like, the sister on turn 3 is going to see that it's finished. He can do nothing anymore.
Mm-hmm. Poor sisters. Let's go on to another T3 army. Sometimes they have just T5 or T6 in the whole army. Didokrati are very hot right now. Many people are actually taking them, even though they were not Eldari player at all before, because they seem like the newest hotness. I would just give you like a broad list that we have been seeing winning tournaments, and this is like very heavy on raiders, incubi, lots of witches, the hellions, and of course crazy characters, more crazy than the fangmaster from the Harlequins. I'm definitely saying that Drukhari are nowhere like explored yet, and especially with allies, with Harlequins or with Craftworks, they can do a lot of things. But maybe if you just take this list that has been very hot, what are your thoughts on the matchup, and maybe also a bit on the Drukhari in general?
So I think my list need to change for that. But I think I'm going to change my list for that. I'm going to talk that after. But the big problem I think is that the big, like, you're still faster than them, so that's a nice point. So let's begin positively and take the good point. You're still faster than them, and you still trade relatively well. Like, I mean, if there is a boat in front of you, you kill the boat, and you can kill, like, you can kill a lot of them. But the problem is that they're so cheap, and that even if you think you kill a lot, like you kill two raider with everything there is inside, and there is still like four raider left, and you're there. All right, okay. So if they invest into like the big Elion units, that give you, like, if they invest into big expensive unit like 20 men Elion, but I don't think like the best deals do that. But that gives you a more easy shot, because the Elion, you can see where they go, you can trade them, like you're going to go. But and what's, so that's nice, but the problem for me is like the how many layout of trade they have. Like, if you kill a boat, there is a character that can trade for whatever new army that's coming. Also, another part is the incubi and the rolling dice. Like, if by, like, even if there is no minus one leadership in the way, if they manage to roll a 9 on the 2 dice, that just fuck up all your strategy. And you cannot count on that happen or not. So that's really big. I think overall, for the moment, Harlequin tend to lose a little bit against Dark Eldar. Also, I forgot something. Phantasm Grenade Launcher with Mortal Wound spam are also really obnoxious, because, like we say, Mortal Wound are obnoxious, and they can get that really easily with like minus 2 minute leadership, and then you take like 7 Grenade Launcher in the face, and you just lose a unit of bike from that, and that costs him nothing, basically. So, yeah. No, I need to train that matchup. So I think right now I lose, but I'm not sure.
Because he has too many units.
Too many. Yeah, like, yeah. For example, in that matchup, I think the 12-man player doesn't serve anything. Like, you already kill. So, like, he is not difficult to kill. Like, so whatever you do with a unit like this, you cannot trade. So that unit for that matchup need to go out, I think. That's like a too big investment to be able to manage to kill them.
Also, somehow I like to flick with fires more than 5 fusions nowadays.
Yeah. I fucking... 2 liquefier are so good, mate. And so reliable, like, in the opposite. Like, also, they cost 60 points. So in a raider, you have 4 of them. So...
Yeah. Cost almost, like... It's like a 6 meta guns in the Harlequins, yeah.
No. So, no. Maybe I can talk about what I saw about... to win against them?
Yes, please.
Yeah, of course.
So, for first, what I put is, I put the 12-man player out, because, like I say, he doesn't trade up. And I begin to... And also, I saw I need to do damage in every phase. Like, I have to be able to, like, have a strong magic phase, a strong shooting phase. Because also, with the always fight first on the switch, you cannot... charge multiple things, even if he's out of CP, because he's just interrupt for free. So that makes the thing a lot harder. You cannot count on charging. So what I saw is that I was needing a little bit of help from other faction. So I think I'm going to soup Harlequin a little bit more. Like, I already done some tests with souping, and I was enjoyable them. So I thought I would take a little bit of Craftworld part. So basically what I do is I drop a unit of bike, I drop a unit of player, and I drop the fusion pistol of the list. And that gives me a nice point part to go take some units. And a unit that can do a lot of damage in a lot of different phases, and it's relatively cheap, I find, is the Shining Spear. So my idea is to go for 3x3 Shining Spear. Some cheap unit who do good damage into like Raider and stuff like Deacon Shooting, and then I have a little, I have a Farseer with Doom on the Skyweaver with Doom and Executioner, just to be able to Doom a Raider to make sure I can kill it in shooting with the spear. And then having Executioner and Smite, where like you do so much Mortal Wound plus the Shadow Seer that allows you to do a bunch of Mortal Wound. And then I think I have in the list, I have a random unit of Warp Spider to just allow me to don't have to thought about. I can take Scrambler anytime. And that's really important, because Drukhari, one of the weaknesses is that they tend to only have two good secondaries. They doesn't do why we stand very good. They don't have a good way to. There is one is the Sliss, the court of the Archon, but overall they don't do why we stand so great. So they only have like Scrambler and Engage locked, and the last one doesn't work. So if me, I can be able to lock why we stand, Engage and Scrambler. I don't take why we stand in that one. I take Cinderank because Dark Eldar give Cinderank relatively well, and against most army with Raider and the bunch of model they have, you can score like 7 to 8 points without trying, like only playing the game, and you score 8 points. So I would take that. I would take Engage and Scrambler and have him my secondary in a good way. I don't have to throw to buy. And maybe I have a shot about, but need to test, to be honest. It's too early to say anything, I say.
No, so, sounds good, because you can then also really invest all your units. You don't need to babysit your Warby Stanley fight. And you really need all the units in the fight with the Harlequins, the Dukhari.
That's why I have a lot more unit in that list, like the 3x3 Shining Spear. It's a lot of shot, a little bit of combat, and the magic, and even the Warp Spider is a little bit of shot. I have more unit, I think, to beat. I'm trying, and also I'm more faster than Dark Eldar. So I can choose my side and maybe avoid a little bit, but need to trust.
Even the Warp Spiders are not bad against
strength 6. 12 shot strength 6, I take it.
Now, in the discussions of the matchups, several times you've pointed out that this 12-player troop is quite important, or is sometimes the key to success in some matchups. And now you already told how you would change your list according to the Drukhari coming in. So what do you see in the overall meta happening by Drukhari pushing in now? How does that affect overall the playstyle of maybe some different factions as well?
It's going to be harder for Harlequin, I think. We are going to see a lot more like a Contemptor with double Vulkite things, things like that, long-range shooting. And that's the thing I don't like. Like, with Harlequin, it's not that bad. I can deal with because I have AOR, but like I say, I have less everywhere, so I think they are going to go a lot more onto a less high AP, high damage spell. Think to more saturation, like strength 4, like I say, Intercessor kill witch in combat. Like, you don't need Bladeguard to go kill witches or incubi or thing like that. So why not go for them? And that's bad for Harlequin. So it's going to be harder for Harlequin in the meta right now, I think.
Very interesting.
But harder doesn't mean impossible. I think they are still having a shot, and it's still so fun to play them that there is going to have some modification. But like we won't see the, like, that's why I didn't put the 12 men anymore, because I think that if you play big units, you're never going to, like, big unit overall, you can always play the mission. It's a problem, but like, You're going to, if you play big unit against Drukhari, you're just going to get hit, I think. Like, I don't think even, like, Terminator survive to Drukhari.
Maybe no, they don't.
Voilà.
But do you think that the Drukhari are a phase, and it's a hype that many people... this army, I think it's... I don't think it's easy to play, because you can also do a lot of mistakes, but if the opponent doesn't know how to play against it, you can kill him really quickly with the Drukhari. Yeah. And I feel that's one of the reasons, I don't want to downplay the Drukhari, but I think that's one of the reasons why they're now winning the tournaments left and right, because you just have this army. It's many armies, they all kind of look the same, and you just no one knows how to play against them. Maybe their lists are also for a different meta, and then they stand against all these raiders, and then I don't know what to do, and then they go too aggressive, and suddenly everything is dead because the Drukhari just get out and kill everything.
We need to figure out. It's really too early to say. I'm not really good to predict the meta overall. I can adapt myself to the meta really well, but predict is not. I don't know. I often, I take the present and do what with what I have in the present. And right now, yes, we see Turikari. Do we are going to see in the future? I don't know. If we see it, I will be prepared. If we don't, I will be prepared as well. But I'm not the. And but I think if Turikari stay, the meta is going to change for sure. Because.
And do you think with the Drukhari there, like I will just basically I will rephrase my same question, sorry. Do you think they will stay and be strong? Because they, yes, they have lots of output. Yes, they are very quick. But we have seen from this rundown of these matchups, the Harlequins, they can play the mission well and they're really quick. And their biggest advantage, I would say, is always that they can move again many times. Yes. Yeah, they basically move as not only as fast as fast as the opponent, yeah. But also more times.
And
the Drukhari don't do that. They move fast, but they don't move again.
They hit harder. So I agree on that point. That's why I did play Drukhari, test it, and I still prefer Harlequin because it's a like Harlequin is a more lot tricky. There are a lot more trick, and Drukhari is just strength. Like it just is going to hit harder. And I think that's true when the guys are going to adapt, it's going to be harder for the Drukhari. But I still think that what Drukhari have that doesn't have Harlequin is that Drukhari have actually some different entries in the codex.
So,
so they're going to adapt themselves as well. So
more data sheet, yes, that's definitely going to help.
That's for sure. So I will see...
So I hate to break the discussion at this point, but you said it. I think you hit the point here when you said we need to see. We will have to see what the people make of this codex and what units will appear on the table. Yeah. Looking at the time, we are already significantly running over the time span we planned. So I think we should try to close it down now. Frey, do you still have anything on your mind?
No, I will keep all of that for myself now.
Okay, so I think it's time to find a way to close the session. So I will start by thanking you, Liam, for all these insights and for...
Sorry, Tom. I still have thought you would make the last question, which we have in the script.
Which one? For the new players?
Yes.
Okay, then let's put this in. We are so much over time. I tried to... Okay, let's go for this.
No, it's fine. It's fine. Okay.
So I will place the question. The question is...
give a short break for cutting.
Okay.
Please so before we close down and come to the end of the podcast, one question that still is there in the room is for the newer players, for those people starting out and maybe making their first steps with Harlequins, what would be the best advice you could give new players starting into this army, what to look for, what to take care of, and what to be careful about?
Be careful to don't rely on like you surviving. I think the best don't rely on roll for up involved. Like it never happened. And use your trick as you and learn to play the mission. Really, don't play the killing game. Learn to play the mission. It's how to win with Harlequin. Mm-hmm. It's most of the game you don't try to kill. You play the mission. It would be my main advice. Mm-hmm. And also, even if you don't have a lot of data sheets, they can be used in a lot of different ways. You can use back and player in a lot of different ways. So learn how to play them in a different way, because if you don't, you're going to really not enjoy them because it's going to be really repetitive. Like, But really, yes. Harlequin is a very good army, I think, to learn the game overall, because it's all about the mission. And... So that's nice. And it's not easy to play, and that's rewarding as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be my advice.
I think the last part is a great advice. I used to not play Harlequins. I just got into them with 9th edition being a bit let down by Craftwords. And I really found the lack of data sheets very off-turning for myself, because I really want to try and mix a lot of things in and different tools. And... immediately started souping, and maybe as you said, if I just focus on how different I can play all the different how different I can play the same data sheet, I might have had like a quicker learning curve with the Harlequin itself.
Yes, the that's the big problem of the harlequin. So yes, I agree. But souping is also a way. I did souping, and that followed to see other option. And
yeah, yeah, it's great. But as you said, if you can you can lose track of how you can just play these all these different units differently.
Yes.
And I heard a lot that it's always the same. And then if you look at it, and then again, no, this list is different. It has more of this weapon, and look, the Shadow Seer has a different trait, and so on. And they're like, oh, it's all the same. And like, no.
That's different. Yeah. And that's the beauty about Harlequin. One option, change the list.
Yeah.
So still a very versatile army. And I really like this advice of learning to play the mission, because if you don't, you lose. So it's learning the hard way, maybe, because they are not that easy to play. Okay, and I think this sums up our discussion already a little bit. So opening up again, Fred, do you still have anything on the list?
No, I'm super happy. Thank you very much, Liam. This was a great part too, and I'm very happy you came on our podcast.
Thank you, and thanks to you to have me here. It was fun. I always love to talk with 40K.
Yes. So also from my side, thank you very much for your time, for the insights, for the in-depth look into how you design your list, how you play the list, and for everybody else out there, thank you very much for listening. So
thank you very much, guys, and remember we have lots of German podcasts on YouTube here, and all these part two are also on our Patreon page. So if you want to really dig into all these different army lists and want to hear what the players say, we always get the best German players on our podcast and really pick their brains. And also we have a new format where we do some codex review when they come out. We do some like first look, trying to find some combos and give our first impression what this book might bring to competitive play and what army list and concept we might see. So also check out these formats, and yeah, thank you for following us and listening wherever you did listen to this, if it's YouTube or Spotify or whatever. Always grateful for your support on all these platforms. And by that, I now have said my last thing. Thank you, Tom, and I think we can close it down. Thank you very much. Goodbye, guys.
Thanks all. Bye-bye.
Ciao.